So while I was conducting normal internet activities, whatever that means, I found a document named Doc 00026. Well, let's get that. It's about Soviet tank programs, and it's basically a document predicting the next generation of Soviet tanks so NATO wouldn't be caught with its pants down. If they guess wrong, Western armies might invest in the wrong weapons or find themselves facing an unpleasant surprise on the battlefield. If they guess right, well, then maybe they get the upper hand. And it wasn't just a theoretical exercise. Thousands of Soviet tanks were stationed in Eastern Europe, and if the Cold War went hot, those crazy new T-72s and T-80s would be leading the charge. The CIA's predictions would inform how the US upgraded its own tanks, like the M1 Abrams, for example, and anti-tank weapons. Today, we're going to break down what the CIA foresaw, what actually happened with those tanks up to the early 1990s, and where the CIA was right and where it wasn't. Buckle up, or should I say, button up your hatches. Sorry. What the CIA predicted. Based on the intelligence available as of December 1st, 1984, the CIA analysts laid out a version of what the next Soviet main battle tank might look like when it would appear. They also made predictions about upgrades of existing Soviet tanks, but we won't cover them in this video. Firstly, the CIA was convinced that the Soviets were working on a brand new design to roll out by the end of the decade. In their words, Moscow would almost certainly field a completely new tank design by the early 1990s to deal with NATO's growing anti-tank capabilities. They saw that Western armies were deploying more lethal anti-tank missiles, high-penetration shells, attack helicopters, and so on. So the Soviets wouldn't just sit and watch. The CIA's predictions didn't have schematics from some spy in a trench coat, but they extrapolated from trends and what was already happening in Soviet research and development. They expected significantly improved protection for Soviet tanks, possibly including new composite armor formulas and explosive reactive armor built in. In fact, even as the CIA wrote the report, their intelligence had spotted Contact 1 ERA bricks on Soviet T-64B tanks in eastern Germany, and the CIA correctly suspected this would be a big part of future designs. They figured the new tank would incorporate integral ERA or other advanced armor to defeat the latest NATO warheads. The CIA analysts also believed the Soviets would stick with their 125mm smoothbore gun for a while, because that gun was no fun. This rhymed. It was already standard on T-64, T-72 and T-80s and could fire APFSDS rounds and even anti-tank guided missiles. The report noted that the 125mm gun still had significant potential for performance growth, so an immediate jump to a bigger gun, like the rumored 130mm or 152mm, wasn't expected. Instead, they predicted improvements in ammunition, for instance, new armor-piercing rounds, and possibly enhancements like a gun-launched missile system on all future tanks. The T-64B could fire an ATGM, which is the AT-8 Songster, through the gun tube, and the CIA anticipated that capability would be standard going forward. The CIA also predicted more advanced targeting and night fighting gear. Western tanks were starting to get thermal imagers around that time, giving them a big advantage at night. The Soviets lacked in true thermal sights in 1984, but the CIA figured they would strive to develop their own thermal imaging or improve night vision in the new tank. They also expected better ballistic computers and lasers, anything to improve first shot hit probability. The report even mentioned active protection measures, things like laser detectors, dazzlers or smoke dispensers to counter Western laser-guided missiles. Generally, they expected the kind of stuff we later saw as Stora infrared jammers on tanks. When it came to engine power, the CIA knew the T-80's gas turbine engine gave it high speed but guzzled fuel like a 20-year-old German guzzles beer. They likely debated whether the Soviets would continue with turbines or go back to diesel for a new design. The prediction was that whatever engine they had in the new tank, it would be more powerful and more reliable. They expected the Soviets to push for a high power-to-weight ratio, which means more horsepower per ton, so that the new tank could go fast despite heavier armor, but hopefully without the T-80's logistical problems. In numeric terms, you could expect over 1,000 horsepower engines becoming the norm. For a comparison, the T-72B in 1985 got about 840 horsepower. The analysts also discussed Soviet efforts in anti-tank weapon countermeasures. For example, they mentioned Soviet research into smoke screens that could defeat laser-guided weapons or active defense systems that might shoot down incoming missiles. A futuristic Soviet tank, they thought, could incorporate some whiz-bang gadgetry to handle NATO's new top-attack munitions or tandem-charged warheads. Remember, by the mid-80s, NATO was developing smarter ways to destroy tanks like the American TOW-2A with a tandem warhead to defeat ERA, or the British Law 80 with a precursor charge. The CIA basically said the Soviets aren't blind. They see these threats and will design their next tank to survive them. Lastly, the CIA predicted the Soviets would continue mass-producing tanks at high rates and modernize their tank factories. The report detailed the expansion and modernization of production lines at facilities like Chelyabinsk, Nizhny Tagil, Omsk and Kharkov, each tied to different tank models. They foresaw the USSR cranking out and improving T-72s and T-80s to replace older T-55s and T-62s in huge numbers. Essentially, quality and quantity was the Soviet approach. Lots of tanks getting steadily more advanced. This was something NATO strategists had difficulties dealing with. It's one thing to face a handful of super tanks, but another to face thousands of very good tanks. As to what really happened, we today have the luxury of knowing what actually rolled out of Soviet and later Russian factories by the end of the Cold War. Perhaps the biggest miss in the CIA's forecast was the timing and appearance of a completely new design. The predicted Soviet tank of the 1990s, a next-generation wonder that would render all the T-72s and T-80s obsolete, never fully materialized by the end of the Cold War. There was indeed work on new tanks, more on that in a second, but none of them actually reached operational service before the USSR collapsed. Instead, what the Soviets did field were significant upgrades of existing models, and not an all-new ground-up tank. The CIA thought a new design was a sure thing by the early 90s. In reality, the Soviets tried, but history had other plans. The USSR did initiate an advanced tank program in the late 80s. There were prototypes like the Object 187, which was a highly improved experimental tank only loosely based on the T-72, and a radical project often called the FST-2 or Object 477 Molot in Kharkov, with a rumored 152mm gun. Fancy stuff, huh? However, none of these saw the light of day. By 1990 to 1991, the Soviet Army did have a new tank design in trials, but it wasn't the game-changer the CIA envisioned. It was the T-72B upgrade project, Object 188, which the Soviets ultimately chose. This tank would enter service in 1992 as the T-90. And here's the joke, the T-90 was basically an evolutionary upgrade of the T-72B, not a revolutionary Star Wars tank. It featured many enhancements like a new fire control system from the T-80U, thermosites, a more powerful engine and contact 5 ERA all around, but it wasn't a dramatic improvement. It even kept the same 125mm gun with better ammo. In terms of mobility, there was a mix. The T-80U's turbine gave it brutal acceleration and speed, but it was thirsty and finicky, as the CIA might have guessed. The diesel in the T-80UD and T-72B was more reliable and efficient. By the early 90s, the Soviet tank force was a logistical mixture. Three different engines, the T-64's 5TDF diesel, the T-72's V-84 diesel, and the T-80's GTD-1000 turbine, each with their pros and cons. The CIA didn't explicitly predict that diversity, they probably assumed the Soviets would standardize an engine, but post-Cold War, the Russians themselves realized that this was unsustainable. In the 1990s, the Russian army actually favored the simpler T-72B and T-90 design over the high-performance T-80, largely because of maintenance and fuel issues. That's an interesting twist. The CIA in 1984 might have assumed that the gas turbine T-80 line was the future, but in practice, the cheaper, easier T-72 lineage won out in the long run. When it comes to production, the Soviets did push tank production hard through the 80s as the CIA anticipated, but we now know there were limits. By around 1989, some tank factories like the Chelyabinsk tractor plant stopped production because the economy was going badly. In 1990, the Omsk plant building the T-80s slowed down as well. The CIA couldn't predict the Soviet economic collapse, so they assumed a consistent boom. In reality, tank output peaked in the 1980s and then nosedived as the USSR fell apart. By early 1992, Russia's newly formed military had thousands of tanks, but many factories had ceased or cut production or fell into the hands of other countries like Ukraine. The mighty Soviet tank industry basically hit a brick wall at the end of the Cold War, something that no one in 1984 really saw coming. So you could say that the Soviet 1980s tank developments largely followed the evolutionary path the CIA predicted, but the revolutionary jump did not happen. Instead of a shiny new tank dominating the 90s, the Soviet Union collapsed and the best hardware on the field remained the T-80U or T-80UD, and the latest T-72B variants, of course. The first T-90s, which came right after the Cold War, can theoretically be seen as the successor of all those programs. Anyways, that was all I had for you today. Like this video, subscribe, share your honored opinion in the comments, and I'll see you the next time.